in the past. We have lots of right to privacy with our warrants and wiretaps. Those deemed enemy combatants still endure their long ordeals. We the people must restore the right of
words by Joan Dorris.
Thank you.
do. The giving title, we have just one rule. And you know, soon, so how long?
You have to give me the free.
We have just one world, there's only one world, complete with sunshine, wind, and rain, with ancient forests and tranquil oceans, and living streams and fields of grain. We have just one
Grannies. Give it up. high bar this evening, and I'm taking my cue from them. Good evening. My name is Bill Dwight. I'm the president of the Northampton City Council. I have the privilege of being the MC today. And I'm very grateful that everyone has taken the time to step out on our first snow to come participate in this. I think motivated more by your conscience than by, well, at least my presence, I'm sure. So thank you all for coming, and people will be following me as we do this. And in typical UU fashion, we're all going to behave as if we're among friends, because we are. Since 2002, our local Northampton area chapter of the Raging Granny has been promoting peace and human rights through song and humor. We've seen them at virtually every event promoting social justice here in the Valley and beyond. They performed on stage, of course, and at demonstrations and on the streets, and at events like this. And so, if you would please thank them for me once more. You're singing first night? Oh yeah, gigs. Let's see, okay. The Raging Grannies would have some gigs. You're going to be singing first night, when else? 5 o'clock, it's Garrick, across the street, first night, not too far away from that.
Bring the,
yes. You guys going to be collecting money at that event? You guys never open up with a car case or anything, okay? You certainly have hats, you can, okay. So welcome to, it's in our hands, a call to action. This is a celebration of the 65th anniversary of the Declaration of Human Rights. We'd like to also acknowledge the death last week of one of the greatest advocates for human rights and social justice and racial justice, Nelson Mandela, his funeral. I'm not sure of the time at this point, but some point during the last day. And it's actually appropriate that we assemble on this day, because Nelson Mandela, of course, is a man of our time, when so few people of our time have presented themselves with such virtue and such honor and such courage, so that we actually have an example. We don't have to harken back centuries past. We have someone we were alive to witness, and he has passed. We hope this celebration and call to action honors his memory and provides many of us here with an inspiration to continue advocating for human rights here in the community and around the world. And it's particularly important. I want to point out, you'll see the room is ringed with small pieces of art. These are pictures that were drawn by the fifth grade students of Leeds. Let's see. Oh, Leslie, how am I going to pronounce your last name? Makowitz? Makowitz? That's okay. Makowitz. All right, thank you, Leslie. Is the art teacher at Leeds Elementary School. And each picture illustrates a human right described in one of the articles of the Declaration, the Universal Declaration, which you will be hearing tonight, read by, well, about a third of the audience, is the way it's panning out. So I encourage you to check them out. They're actually quite stunning and arresting. And when you have a chance, maybe when the program is over or as you're milling about. I also want to thank, all the people of, at events like this, we point out the celebrities such as they are, or the political celebrities, and we have a few here, as it were. And all things being local, former Mayor Claire Higgins is over here. City Councilor Marianne LeBard of Ward 6 is here. Councilor-elect of Ward 7, Elisa Klein, is here. And Mayor David J. Narkowitz is also here in the front row. entering our newest close force for the City Council, Ryan O'Donnell, representing Ward 3. And I think that's the end of our August assembly here.
Pam Schwartz.
Is Ward's Marine Corps?
Pam Schwartz.
Oh, Pam Schwartz. Oh. Lame duck counselor from Ward 4, Pamela Schwartz is here. Sorry about that. And then there's me. This event's been organized by the Human Rights Commission and the Social Justice Committees for the City of Northampton and of the Unitarian Society of Northampton Florence. And so we have a full evening scheduled for you, so I'm going to start right now, and I'm going to introduce Reverend Janet Bush, Minister of the Unitarian Society of Northampton and Florence. Woo!
So I'm very happy to welcome you tonight on behalf of the Unitarian Society of Northampton and Florence. This congregation boasts a tradition of commitment to justice and human rights that extends back into the 19th century. So I am going to share a few words from someone who is long gone, the great and courageous Unitarian abolitionist and preacher Theodore Parker, who was a Bostonian. He said, "I am to do justice, and I demand that of all, a universal human debt, a universal human claim." And he goes on to say, "I do not pretend to understand the moral universe. The arc is a long one, my eye reaches but little way. And I cannot calculate the curve and complete the figure by the experience of sight. I can divine it by conscience, and from what I see, I am sure it bends towards justice." You may know, remember that Martin Luther King Jr. often echoed those words. And as Bill said, we think tonight also, we can't help but think of Nelson Mandela. So let us remember him and all of those famous and forgotten who are working and who have worked for human rights with the same faith that Theodore Parker had, that same ability to divine by conscience. Let us bear witness tonight to hope and to faith in the arc of a moral universe that bends towards justice.
Carol Reinhart is the current co-chair of the Northampton Human Rights Commission. She's been a member of the commission for 6 years. And she's leaving us. Sad to say that she will be leaving the Human Rights Commission, which will be a substantial loss. And actually, while I've got you here, I might as well recruit anyone who's interested in joining the Human Rights Commission for the City of Northampton. And I understand there's an opening for chair. Sorry, that's too soon. But please consider joining the Northampton Human Rights Commission. It is good work, it is hard work, and I think Carol can attest to sometimes frustrating. And we'll do what we can to make sure it's less frustrating. I think that's our job. Carol will be talking about the history and the importance of celebrating the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Ladies and gentlemen, Carol Reinhart, please welcome her.
This is so funny. Bill gets his cliff notes on what to say I'm going to say, and that's not what I plan to say. So he said some of what I plan to say. I welcome you. It's so wonderful to have you here, and this is such a wonderful event. And is it not a remarkable coincidence that the leaders of the world are assembled this very day to pay homage to Nelson Mandela? He's been such a source of hope and encouragement to people working for human rights and racial justice throughout his 95 years. I've been struck in rereading parts of The Long Walk to Freedom that he was the son of a chief, and he always knew himself. And I think that's an enviable and remarkable quality. He understood the importance of human rights and the role of leadership from the moment he drew breath, and he never doubted it. Can any of us say that? When Nelson Mandela was 30 years old, Eleanor Roosevelt and 48 countries' representatives made the Declaration of Human Rights, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. I can well imagine that as he read about that happening, at the same time he was hearing that the Afrikaner Party had been elected, far more influenced by the Nazi regime than their predecessor, he knew how important the concern for human rights is and was at that time. So I do want to thank many people who worked hard to make this happen tonight. And I'm not going to repeat those who are mentioned in your beautiful program, but I would like to raise up Eamon Edge, who's a member of our Human Rights Commission, who did such a fabulous, creative job in the work that he's put together on our program and on our brochure. I also want to give a shout out to Sarah Weinberger. Sarah has been the co-chair with me this year of the Northampton Human Rights Commission, and she has chaired the subcommittee for this Human Rights Day event with a great deal of steely vision and determination to make us give this chance to have us mark this time. She herself is in the Middle East right now on a human rights project that is dear to her heart. And that is something that has prompted her to decide also to move on from the local to the national and international work that she'll continue to do. I will most humbly continue on the advisory board for the Human Rights Commission with the same pleasure and admiration for the human rights commissioners that I have already gained in the course of my time with the Human Rights Commission here in Northampton and the chance that we have to work with the City Council. I would like to ask the other people on the Planning Subcommittee to stand or at least wave, and that is Jordana Amato, Rick Hart, Heather Johnson, Ken Maria, Tammy Edwin, and I want to ask all the other human rights commissioners, Eamon and Julio, to raise your hands also as part of the group. So I want to also just simply say that, as Bill said, there are openings for the commission coming up. Applications for appointment can be made through the mayor's office. And be sure to take a look at this gorgeous brochure. It tells you how you can apply and the kinds of things that we're doing. But it's most important to know that you don't have to necessarily be a human rights commissioner to be working, as we sure do know here in this room, on the issues of human rights and basic justice that apply to our work on every level, local, national, and international. And so the commission really gives an extra spur to the work that so many of you are already doing, and that is an important bridge that we're able to play. So thanks for being here. Thanks to you, 1,000 thanks for being you. Each one working in your own way to be a part of the arc that is bending toward justice. Sometimes, and we'll feel this tonight as we listen to these words, sometimes it feels like there's more struggle than hope. We're going to be really struck by the kinds of things, each time we hear these, of the things that are not there yet. And yet, as a good mentor to me once said, in the struggle is the hope. Let us continue this struggle, and now on with the evening. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Northampton Community Music Center Children's Choir.
Follow the drinking door.
Community Music Center Children's Choir once again. Okay, well, apparently the dressing bar has been raised. So we went from the raising grade to now the children who actually showed me up. So that's... they always do. They always do. I'll tell you a little bit about them. They're a multicultural singing group that started in October as a way of building friendship and community among students of different backgrounds and abilities. The Northampton Community Music Center believes that singing creates lasting bonds while building musical skills through the joy of singing. The choir is underwritten by a grant from the Ramsey Mikulski Family Foundation, so there's no charge for the children to take part. And this is their first public appearance. Joan Cornaccio directed the choir, and Sarah L. was accompanying them on the piano. So. Now, it's interesting that we come and we assemble at this particular point in South Africa. They're congregating for Nelson Mandela's funeral, as I said, and the news has come out of that. The outrage and opprobrium has been heaped because Barack Obama did the simple act of friendship and shook the hand of Raul Castro, and that has created a huge stir. We've come to that. It's very important that we assemble on a day like today when there happens to be outrage that two leaders of a country actually shook hands. We have come to a pretty pass, and there's clearly some work to do. Next up, last week in the council meeting, it was Thursday, that's when we have them, I guess, and you can program your DVR to see it on TV if you ever want to. That's the council approved proclamation signed by the mayor proclaiming today as Human Rights Day in the city of Northampton, and to do a live version of that proclamation, Mayor David J. Narcoitz is here and will make a presentation.
Always happy to shake the council president's hand. It's a great honor and pleasure to be with you this evening, and I want to echo thanks to Carol and to Sarah and to all the members of the Human Rights Commission and all the organizers who put together this event. It's my great privilege to issue this proclamation dated today, December 10, 2013, entitled Human Rights Day. Whereas Tuesday, December 10, 2013 marks the 65th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights signed by the United Nations General Assembly following the defeat of fascist expansionism and genocide. And whereas all people share fundamental rights based solely on their common humanity. And whereas, as stated in the preamble to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, recognition of the inherent dignity and of the equal and inalienable rights of all members of the human family is the foundation of freedom, justice, and peace in the world. And whereas the city of Northampton has long held a prominent place in American history for our community's support of peace, social justice, and human rights, and whereas the city's formation of our Human Rights Commission is the tangible expression of our support for human rights, and whereas the primary responsibility to promote respect for those rights and freedoms lies with each individual of this nation, and each of us can play a major role in enhancing human rights. And whereas on December 10th, 2013, in observance of Human Rights Day 2013, it's in our hands, community members have come together to publicly declare their support of humanity's hopes as expressed in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And whereas this proclamation is co-sponsored by the City Council Committee on Social Services and Veterans Affairs, chaired by Councilor Marianne LaBarge, now therefore I, Mayor David Narcoitz, do hereby proclaim December 10th, 2013, to be Human Rights Day in the city of Northampton. I invite our community to affirm and protect the human rights of all people as set forth in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, so that these rights will flourish and will be made available to all. In witness whereof, I have set my hand and imprinted the city seal this 10th day of December in the year 2013. Again, it's a pleasure to be with you, and I look forward to the rest of the program. Thank you.
I eat so much pollen in real life. Next up, we have Jordan Almato, member of the Human Rights Commission. And she's going to introduce our guest speaker, my neighbor, Josh Miller. Josh lost here, I wrote, which is a point of shame with me, but that's okay. Josh is frequently showing me up. He runs for fun, you know, I don't know. Josh is the Smith College School of Social Justice, and he'll be giving our keynote speech. Please welcome Jordan Almato, please.
It's my great privilege to introduce a teacher of mine and our keynote speaker for this evening's celebration. Dr. Josh Miller is an associate dean and professor at the Smith College School for Social Work, where he focuses primarily on anti-racism work and psychosocial capacity building in communities recovering from disasters. In addition to his teaching at Smith, Dr. Miller responds to disasters locally, nationally, and internationally, including September 11th, Hurricane Katrina, the Asian tsunami, and earthquakes in Haiti and China. He also conducts anti-racism workshops in social service agencies, hospitals, and schools. His most recent books include Psychosocial Capacity Building in Response to Disasters and Racism in the U.S., Implications for the Helping Profession. Smith College School for Social Work is approaching its 20th anniversary of becoming an anti-racism institution, and Dr. Miller serves as chair of the Anti-Racism Consultation Committee. As will become evident in his speech, Dr. Miller believes that white people carry an obligation to confront racism every day and for all of our lives. Please welcome Dr. Josh Miller.
I felt like I had to run up here just to kind of show Bill that I still have a little bit of energy left after walking here tonight. I just want to say that I am really honored to be speaking to you at such an important commemoration of one of those really rare moments in world history where humanity collectively embraced a moral position, a position that, as we've heard earlier, was informed by two world wars and horrific genocidal campaign against Jews, Gypsies, and other groups. So I'm really proud of living in a community where there is a Human Rights Commission, and one that is active, that's vibrant, and that is relevant. So I just want to thank the Commission for inviting me to speak to you both tonight, and also for all of you who have turned out for such an important event. Just want to briefly tie in what I will be talking about with today's anniversary. The efforts to establish the Universal Declaration of Human Rights involved many countries, many people, but there was one person in particular, a Polish Jew named Raphael Lemkin, whose life work really was centered on making sure that this was passed. He was a Polish Jew and an international lawyer. And after the UN adopted this resolution, there was a lot of debate in this country about whether it should be ratified in the United States. And President Harry Truman supported it, and he spoke out on behalf of the resolution, but there was tremendous resistance in the United States Senate. And as Samantha Power, who has written a book about genocide called The Problem from Hell, sounds like we have a Samantha Power fan in these moments, the most prominent opponent of ratification, and I hate to say this to all the lawyers in the room, was Alfred T. Schwepp, who was chairman of the American Bar Association's Committee on Peace and Law through the UN. Powers quotes Schwepp as saying that his opposition was based on the following, and I'm quoting now. If I want to drive 5 Chinamen out of town at gunpoint, it does not mean that I intend to destroy all 400 million Chinese in the world. Right? That was said at a Senate hearing. It's an interesting example because Chinese residents, and I use the term resident and not citizen because at the time that I would be talking about, they could not become citizens. Chinese residents of the United States had been chased out of communities at gunpoint. And they were the targets of pogroms. The city of Seattle would empty all of its Chinese citizens at gunpoint out of the city after the Transcontinental Railroad was built. And the Chinese Exclusion Act in 1882, which was signed by Chester Arthur, and by the way, that was a time when immigrants from Europe were being encouraged to come to this country. In fact, probably many of us in this room descend from people who emigrated to this country more or less around that time. That act is not repealed until 1943, 5 years before the declaration was passed at the UN. Okay. 7 years before the United States Senate was debating this. And the United States Senate, senators needed to be reassured, and they were reassured, that this declaration did not cover, quote, lynchings, race riots, and segregation. There was also anti-Semitism that was directed at Lemkin, who was tirelessly pushing for ratification by the United States Senate. So this declaration was not ratified in 1950, and its binding power for all nations to subscribe to its principles is still contested in this country. This is still an unsettled matter, even though we've made a lot of progress. I want to say that I don't find this surprising given our country's history of racism, which I now want to turn to. Everybody here knows we have a constitution. It was followed by a Bill of Rights. And it was based on the notion of a social contract between the government and its people. And we all know about the inalienable rights like freedom, security, equality. But I think, again, everybody in this room is aware of this. Many of the drafters of the Constitution and our early presidents held African Americans as slaves and advocated for and perpetrated and participated in genocide and ethnic cleansing of Native Americans. Our first 12 presidents, out of our first 12 presidents, only 2, the Adams, were not slaveholders. So, as the social philosopher Charles Mills has said, there was this social contract, but there was an underbelly of the social contract, which he terms the racial contract. And this racial contract was an implicit justification of racial categorization and justifying group distinctions based on an illusion, race, but with very real consequences, racism. If we pull out a dollar bill, or a $10 bill, or a $20 bill, we see the pictures of slaveholders and genocidists in this country. There are very few countries that still have people with that kind of history so prominently displayed in such public domains. And part of why I'm bringing this up is one of my themes tonight is how racism has been part of this country's social contract from the beginning, and it is so prevalent, including on our money, that it seems normal. And if we think about the ways that this country is not a democracy, we often talk about how it is a democracy, one of the examples is the U.S. Senate, where a underpopulated, mostly white state like Wyoming has as many senators as a multiracial, densely populated state like California or New York. This descends from this racial contract, and it's really a legacy of what it took to form a nation when many of the states who were forming that nation engaged in slavery. So as I said, part of why I'm going over this is it's part of the normalization of racism that persists to this day. And while when we think of racism, we're often, in our minds, we're often thinking of genocide, slavery, and ethnic cleansing that was central to the founding of the United States. Or maybe we're thinking of the racial codes or the informal slavery where African American men were first forced to work in mines and in factories for no pay after the Civil War, or lynching, or Jim Crow, or segregated schools, which were still permitted in this country until 1954. I guess what I want to say is, thankfully, those are not what we are encountering today, but racism is still very much with us. It's part of this country's DNA from birth. It's a resistant strain that mutates and endures. It doesn't look the same, but it has not completely gone away. We see it structurally. We see it by who gets stopped, arrested, convicted, and incarcerated in this country, not people who look like me. We see it in who gets asked to show photo IDs when they're using their credit cards in shops, including shops in Northampton, according to my colleagues and students of color. Or who's being followed when they enter the store. Again, not somebody who looks like me. Or in our increasingly segregated neighborhoods, which has been a trend that's been going in the wrong direction. The arc has not been leaning the way we would hope. When we notice who are the CEOs or the heads of Fortune 500 companies or baseball team owners, who are the majority of the elected politicians in this country, then we do start seeing people who look like me. We see it in the notion of whiteness, which is a concept that eventually conscripted many European immigrants who were not initially considered white. The Irish, Italians, Jews, Greeks, for example. And we see it in the veil of invisible to white people, privilege, which many people in this room benefit from, even if we consciously deplore it. And we see it in stereotypes, which research has confirmed over and over again, shows that white people hold stereotypes towards people of color, which inform seemingly benign choices in life. Where do we live? What schools do we send our children to? When do we decide to cross the street? What we think, what is said, what is expected of other people. There's been lots of studies that show that white people who are asked if they harbor feelings of racism, and they disavow that, are shown pictures of African-American faces, their heart rates, their eye blinking rates, their sweating all increases, while it doesn't do so when they're looking at pictures of white faces. Reverend Andrea Bazian said to me many years ago that racism is in the air that we breathe. It's so ubiquitous, it infects us all, and it appears to be the normal state of affairs for those who benefit from it, which is reinforced by institutions, by public discourses. And I know we've heard a lot of criticism of President Obama tonight, much of it warranted, but I do want to say that he is our first African-American president, and some of the opposition to him and to his laws is because of his race. And where does the unbending Republican opposition to the Affordable Care Act come from? It's never presented as a racialized discourse, but I want to come back to it. So a lot of things are framed as neutral when it comes to race. And it becomes part of people's internal maps. It's not just what's outside of us, it's also what's inside of us. And this leads to cognitive and emotional distortions. A common form of racism today is what is often called microaggressions, which are common acts of disregard. They're perpetrated by people with race privilege, white people, and they're directed at people of color. It's usually beyond the conscious awareness of the person who's engaged in a microaggression. Usually the person who's doing this, if you ask them, are you racist? Do you have stereotypes? The answer would be no. Examples of microaggressions are expecting members of a targeted group to speak for all members of that group, having lower or at times unreasonably higher expectations for members of that group, unconscious mistrust, rendering people invisible or ignored, or even simple body language. There's studies that show how close people stand to one another or whether they make eye contact are all influenced by one's race. I also want to say that my students of color and colleagues of color often talk about experiencing microaggressions in my school, Smith College School for Social Work, which, as Jordana has said, has made a 20-year commitment to becoming an anti-racism institution. And virtually all of my colleagues of color describe how, as professors, they are asked questions by students that consistently challenges their credibility. What do they really know about their topic? Where did they get their facts from? And I have to say that I've been teaching for decades and I have never been challenged that. If this is not bad enough, having things like microaggressions still part of our interactions between people, we have a Supreme Court that's just dismantled one of the few protections that really contributed to the bend in the arc of human progress towards social justice, the Voting Rights Act. And voter ID laws have sprouted up since that decision in many states, and not coincidentally, in my opinion, many of the same states that have been actively resisting the Affordable Care Act. As many people have said, the price for what can be done is can always be undone, and the price for freedom is eternal vigilance. But having said all that I have just covered, I just want to say that I do remain hopeful. Because despite our history of racism, we have made progress. What was considered legitimate and normative in the past is unacceptable. As Bob Dylan said, if I don't climb to the top of the hill, I know my baby will. And I would add to that, perhaps his baby's grandchildren, or their grandchildren, or grandchildren. I'm hopeful because if we step back and we look at the moral arc of human progress over the centuries and decades, it does bend towards racial justice. But, as President Obama said, it doesn't bend on its own. It's because of the laying of many hands on that arc. And that's what I want to finish up with, which is how did that arc bend in the direction that it does point to, and what can all of us do? Of course, we need leaders, and I've been very conscious of, and I know most people in this room have been thinking of this also, about the passing of Nelson Mandela. And we need leaders of his caliber, and when I think of him, I think of his courage, his fortitude, his vision, but also his immense compassion. And I want to come back to that. And people like Martin Luther King Jr., who gave his life in the search for freedom after leading perhaps the most transformative social movement this country has ever known. But it's not just leaders of that caliber. Their search, their quest for social justice and racial equality has depended on millions of people who shared their vision and who worked in their own ways to achieve this. People like us in this room. So what are some of the steps we can take to keep bending humanity's moral arc towards justice? I want to suggest four broad things. The first is to see and hear racism. While most people of color are well aware of this, many white people are not. And without this step, people do not know what we are confronting. We have to train, particularly white people have to train one's eyes, one's ears. And not only because white people are not ensnared in the web of institutional racism that people of color experience all too often, and are often unaware of its existence, because that's one of the insidious things about this racial contract, is it not only granted racial privileges to white people, but it also did it in such a way that those privileges are often not visible. So, I guess what I want to say is that every day, in every room, at every meeting, while watching every television show, while walking down the street, while going to the Iron Horse, while running in the hot chocolate race, everywhere we need to notice who's there and who's missing. Who are the leaders? Who are the spokespersons? And what images are being used? And where did these come from? And although Northampton has become a much more diverse community than it was when I moved here over 30 years ago, why are Springfield and Holyoke so much more racially and ethnically diverse than Northampton? How did that happen? Or more importantly, why is it still that dynamic? I think what we have to do is similar to what happens to the hero in the film The Matrix, which is we have to remove whatever rose-tinted glasses any of us, and I include myself, may be wearing, and notice the real world we inhabit. So that's the first thing. White people in particular have to listen, look, and notice. But secondly, I want to say that we're not alone, and we must do this work together. Racism, by its very nature, is the ultimate form of isolation. It's based on dehumanization and scapegoating of other people. Human connection acts as a solvent against the rust of racism. And just like the civil rights movement in this country, the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa, all social movements take many, many people who do very different things in our own ways, but working towards a common goal, responding to this web of racism with a web of resistance. So we need to find people who share our vision. Perhaps wanting to confront racism in public schools, as people in this room have provided leadership and have been doing. Or concerns about racial profiling, or the lack of elected leaders of color in so many communities, and we need to work together. We can form unlearning racism or anti-racism support groups, create coalitions of people like the Human Rights Commission who want to do something about racism. And while I describe how most people, particularly white people, have their thoughts and feelings unconsciously shaped by the structures and history of this country, the majority of people, including white people, are consciously against racism. So we have to harness the power of our numbers. The third thing I want to talk about involves compassion. I really feel like we have to be compassionate to ourselves and to others. We have to be compassionate to those who are targeted by racism and work unrelentingly to oppose it. But we also have to be compassionate to those who work to unlearn it, which can be a frustratingly slow and messy process. My friend, colleague, and anti-racism activist Mike Funk signs his letters, One Love. Nobody in this room designed racism. We're all victims of racism in various ways. It slams doors and constricts opportunities for those who are targeted by it. But it morally compromises those who benefit from it, leading to lives informed by distortions and by fears. I would categorize this work, this way of working against racism, as compassionate, personal, and interpersonal work. It can be painful, such as when an unwanted stereotype floats up from the swamp of your psyche. But such stereotypes will continue to bubble up unless we notice them, reflect on them, think about where we learned them, and what sustains them. Ultimately, this work is liberating and freeing for us all. Guilt, shame, anger, and critical judgment can get in the way of confronting and ultimately exorcising these demons. I think one of Nelson Mandela's greatest legacies was his vision of justice that included a deep capacity for compassion, and it's an essential ingredient in my experience when we work towards racial justice. Lastly, we need to remain engaged in this struggle against racism, one that has lasted for centuries, and where many people gave their lives as part of that struggle. We need to raise our voices, write letters, sign petitions, follow the lead of the raging grannies, demonstrate, elect people like our elected officials in the room tonight who oppose racism and stand for social justice. We need to sponsor legislation like the resolution that was sponsored by Congresswoman Judith Chu in 2012 that formally expressed the regret of the House of Representatives for the Chinese Exclusion Act. There's a lot in our past that needs to be excavated, apologized for, and repaired. And our failure to adequately do this is part of the heritage of racism that continues to defile our country. Some of us, some who we admire in this room today, will engage in acts of civil disobedience to protest laws and policies and practices that harm other people. We also need to work to support laws, as imperfect as they might be, that benefit all of our people. We need to push back against the congressmen and congresswomen who represent predominantly white districts and do not want to see President Obama succeed with anything that he proposes, who want his health care initiative to fail, who don't want, quote, those, unquote, people receiving government benefits. We need not to be rocked back on our heels, but rather what anti-racism activist Bobby Harrow encourages us to do, make a noise, a deep, resounding clamor demanding universal human rights and social justice for all of our citizens and ultimately for all of the world's population. If we believe that we are all human beings, all members of the only race, the human race, then we all carry the scar of racism, and in my view, are obligated to heal and overcome the legacy of that scar. So on this 65th anniversary of the signing of the UN Universal Declaration of Human Rights, an act informed by the same ideals that are enshrined in our Constitution that highlights where we've fallen short, as well as shining a beacon that illuminates the intentional country that we hope to become. As Eleanor Roosevelt said, it's in our hands. I want to quote her. Where, after all, do universal human rights begin? In small places, close to home, so close and so small they cannot be seen on any maps of the world. For me, unquote. For me, this includes the inner maps that are parts of our psyches and souls. I'm going to finish with a quote from Nelson Mandela. A fundamental concern for others in our individual and community lives would go a long way in making the world a better place that we so passionately dream of. Stay concerned and keep on dreaming. Thank you.
Right now, Lisa Amato and Lisa Goggin first met as colleagues in the Valley Therapist Committee. I understand there are a few of them in the Valley. And they soon learned they had more in common than their first names. Both had long-standing roots in the movements for social change. Among other things, this meant that they knew the words to all the same songs. And they're hoping that these are songs that you know too. So joining them on mandolin is Brooks Ballinger, and organized with the UAW. Take it away.
Teaching all of us about the various movements for social justice and for human rights. And one of our great sages and social critics was Woody Guthrie, and so we are hoping that you know this song, and if you don't, you will learn this song because it has an awesome chorus. So if you don't know it now, you will know it.
For these men.
And we're going to hear a reading of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights you've heard so much about this evening, and hopefully you've heard more about it through the course of your lives. The readers include community leaders and people who have advocated for or have been affected by the specific human rights described in the article they are reading. Please refer to the insert of your program for listening to people who are reading, and please note that there have been some changes made because some people were unable to come to do readings tonight, so they've been replaced. As people step up, they will introduce themselves. And if you look to your right, you'll see the words of the articles projected on the screen, along with the photographs, illustrating the human rights being described. And we will start with the preamble, read by Ward 6, Councillor, City Councillor, Northampton City Councillor, Mary Ann LaBarge.
Preamble. Whereas recognition of the inherent dignity and of the equal and inalienable rights of all members of the human family is the foundation of freedom, justice, and peace in the world. Whereas disregard and contempt for human rights have resulted in barbarous acts which have outraged the conscience of humankind, and the advent of a world in which human beings shall enjoy freedom of speech and belief and freedom from fear and want has been proclaimed as the highest aspiration of the common people. Whereas it is essential, if men and women are not to be compelled to have recourse as a last resort to rebellion against tyranny and oppression, that human rights should be protected by the rule of law. Whereas it is essential to promote the development of friendly relations between nations. Whereas the peoples of the United Nations have in the Charter reaffirmed their faith in fundamental human rights, in the dignity and the worth of the human person, and in the equal rights of all people, and have determined to promote social progress and better standards of life and larger freedom. Whereas member states have pledged themselves to achieve, in cooperation with the United Nations, the promotion of universal respect for and observance of human rights and fundamental freedoms. Whereas a common understanding of these rights and freedoms is of the greatest importance for the full realization of this pledge. Now, therefore, the General Assembly proclaims this Universal Declaration of Human Rights as a common standard of achievement for all peoples and all nations, to the end that every individual and every organ of society, keeping this declaration constantly in mind, shall strive by teaching and education to promote respect for these rights and freedoms, and by progressive measures, national and international, to secure the universal and effective recognition and observance both among the peoples of member states themselves and among the peoples of territories under their jurisdiction.
Actually, as we do this, if the person, this will be the on-deck circle over here. So whoever's on deck can step up. And then please introduce yourself so everyone knows who you are.
Hi, I'm Arlo Siegel.
I'm Gabriel Feldman-Schwartz.
And we're representing Northampton Key Club.
All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights.
They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in a spirit that values the inherent worth and connectedness of all members of the human family.
My name is Nora Trias, Article 2. Everyone is entitled to all the rights and freedoms set forth in this Declaration without distinction of any kind, such as race, color, sex, language, religion, political or other opinion, national or social origin, property, birth, or other status. Furthermore, no distinction shall be made on the basis of the political, jurisdictional, or international status of the country or territory to which a person belongs, whether it be independent, trust, non-self-governing, or under any other limitation of sovereignty.
My name is Yael Petretti. Article 3. Everyone has the right to life, liberty, and security of person.
Latanya Robinson couldn't make it. I'm Rudolph Ripley, co-chair of the Unitarian Society of Northampton Social Justice Committee. Article 4, no one shall be held in slavery or servitude. Slavery and the slave trade shall be prohibited in all their forms.
Nancy Delaney. Article 5. No one shall be subjected to torture or to cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment or punishment.
I'm Wendy Bird, legal aid lawyer. Article 6. Everyone has the right to recognition everywhere as a person before the law.
I'm Bill Newman, Article 7. All are equal before the law and are entitled without any discrimination to equal protection of the law. All are entitled to equal protection against any discrimination in violation of this declaration and against any incitement to such discrimination.
I am Susan DeMaria, I'm replacing Chantel. I am a lawyer and I am a union organizer with the National Organization of Legal Services Workers. Everyone has the right to an effective remedy by the competent national tribunals for acts violating the fundamental rights granted by the Constitution or by law.
Article 9. No one shall be subjected to arbitrary arrest, detention, or exile.
Article 10, everyone is entitled in full equality to fair and public hearing by an independent and impartial tribunal in the determination of their rights and obligations and of any criminal charge against them.
Anthony Akin-Meckley, Article 11. Everyone charged with a penal offense has the right to be presumed innocent until proved guilty according to law in a public trial at which he or she has had all the guarantees necessary for the defense. No one shall be held guilty of any penal offense on account of any act or omission which did not constitute a penal offense under national or international law at time when it was committed, nor shall a heavier penalty be imposed than the one that was applicable at the time the penal offense was committed.
I am Josh Levy from Free Press. This is Article 12.
No one shall be subjected to arbitrary interference with their privacy, family, home, or correspondence, nor to attacks upon their honor and reputation. Everyone has the right to the protection of the law against such interference or attacks.
Victor Nunez, Operation Iraqi Freedom Combat Veteran, and public speaker at Veterans Advocacy Services. Article 13, everyone has a right to freedom of movement and residence within the borders of each state. Everyone has a right to leave any country, including their own, and to return to their country.
Hi, my name is Julio Capo. I'm reading Article 14. Everyone has the right to seek and to enjoy in other countries asylum from persecution. This right may not be invoked in the case of prosecution genuinely arising from non-political crimes or from acts contrary to the purposes and principles of the United Nations.
I'm Henry Rosenberg, Article 15. Everyone has the right to a nationality. No one shall be arbitrarily deprived of their nationality, nor denied the right to change their nationality.
Heidi Eugenia Norton Smith, Article 16. All people of full age, without any limitation due to race, nationality, or religion, have the right to marry and to found a family. They are entitled to equal rights as to marriage, during marriage, and at its dissolution.
Marriage shall be entered into only with the free and full consent of the intending spouses. The family is the natural and fundamental group unit of society and is entitled to protection by society and the state.
Emma Schwartz for the Western Massachusetts Network to End Homelessness. Article 17. Everyone has the right to own property alone as well as in association with others. No one shall be arbitrarily deprived of their property.
My name is Tynan Power. Article 18. Everyone has the right of freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. This right includes freedom to change their religion or belief, and freedom, either alone or in community, with others and in public or private, to manifest their religion or belief in teaching, practice, worship, and observance.
My name is Larry Parmenas, the editor of the Daily Hampshire Gazette. Everyone has the right to freedom of opinion and expression. This right includes freedom to hold opinions without interference and to seek, receive, and impart information and ideas through any media and regardless of frontiers.
My name is Ella Napolitano.
I'm Jeff Napolitano. Article 20. Everyone has the right to freedom of peaceful assembly and association. No one may be compelled to belong to an association.
Yvonne Pichero, Article 21. 1. Everyone has the right to take part in the government of their country, directly or through freely chosen representatives. 2. Everyone has the right of equal access to public service in their country. 3. The will of the people shall be the basis of the authority of government. This shall be expressed in periodic and genuine elections, which shall be universal and equal suffrage, and shall be held by secret vote or by equivalent free voting procedures.
This is Article 22. Everyone as a member of society has the right to social security and is entitled to realization through national effort and international cooperation
and in accordance with the organization and resources of each state, of the economic, social, and cultural rights indispensable for their dignity and the free development of their persons.
John Weissman.
I am Kitty Callaghan.
Article 23.1. Everyone has the right to work, to free choice of employment, to just and favorable conditions of work, and to protection against unemployment.
Paragraph 2. Everyone, without discrimination, has the right to equal pay for equal work.
Woo!
Paragraph 3. Everyone who works has the right to just and favorable remuneration, ensuring for themselves and their family an existence worthy of human dignity and supplemented, if necessary, by other means of social protection.
Paragraph 4. Everyone has the right to form and to join trade unions for the protection of their interests.
I am Rosalind Binder, union organizer and executive board member of Western Mass Dodgeville Justice. Article 24, everyone has the right to rest and leisure, including reasonable limitation of working hours and periodic holidays with pay.
Hi, I'm Wanda Ballone. I'm director of Service and Shelter and Housing Division for Hampshire County, and I'm also on the advisory board for the Human Rights Commission. I have Article 25. Everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for their health and well-being and that of their family, including food, clothing, housing, and medical care and necessary social services, and the right to the security in the event of unemployment, sickness, disability, widowhood, old age, or other lack of livelihood in circumstances beyond their control.
I'm Liz Friedman. I'm from Mother Woman. Parenthood and childhood are entitled to special care and assistance. All children, whether born in or out of wedlock, shall enjoy the same social protection.
Hi, my name is Valerie Simone. And everyone has the right to education, shall be free, at least in the elementary and fundamental stages. Elementary education shall be compulsory and technical and professional. Education shall be made greatly available, and higher education shall be equally accessible to all on the basis of merit.
Hey, I'm Raphael. I'm a student. Education shall be directed to the full development of the human personality and to the strengthening of respect for human rights and fundamental freedoms. It shall promote understanding, tolerance, and friendship among all nations, racial or religious groups. It shall further the activities of the United Nations for the maintenance of peace.
Valerie.
Parents have a prior right to choose the kind of education that shall be given to their children.
I'm Penny Burke from the Northampton Center for the Arts. This is Article 27. Everyone has the right freely to participate in the cultural life of the community, to enjoy the arts, and to share in scientific advancement and its benefits. Everyone has the right to the protection of the moral and material interests resulting from any scientific, literary, or artistic production of which they are the author.
Jim Tomczyk.
Article 28. Everyone is entitled to a social and international order in which the rights and freedoms set forth in this declaration can be fully realized.
I'm Cara O'Clair, chair of the Smithsonian organization at Smith College, the anti-genocide organization. Article 29. Everyone has duties to the community in which alone the free and full development of their personality is possible. In the exercise of their rights and freedom, everyone shall be subject only to such limitations as are determined by law solely for the purpose of securing due recognition and respect for the rights and freedoms of others and of meeting the just requirements of morality, public order, and the general welfare in a democratic society. These rights and freedoms may in no case be exercised contrary to the purposes and principles of the United Nations.
I'm Claudia Lefko, the director of the Iraqi Children's Art Exchange and coordinator of Baghdad Resolve, an international collaboration to improve cancer care in Iraq. I'm last. Nothing in this declaration may be interpreted as implying for any state, group, or person any right to engage in any activity or to perform any act aimed at the destruction of any of the rights and freedoms set forth herein.
Elise and Brooks will performance of Brooks, right?
I'm not doing it.
Okay. All right. Brooks is sitting down.
And you, of course. You, of course, I want to teach you. Some of you may know the song. It's by Tommy Sands. Your daughters and your sons? Yeah? Okay, good. Goes like this. Your daughters and your sons, your daughters and your sons, you your daughters and your sons, your daughters and your sons, you've sown the seeds of freedom in your daughters and your sons.
That's it.
Your daughters. Your daughters and your sons, you've sown the seeds of freedom in your daughters and your sons. So, we would like to sing this song in remembrance and in gratitude to the life and the work of Nelson Mandela. Your daughters and your sons, you sow the seeds of equality.
Thank you all very much.